The current head of state of the Netherlands is King William Alexander from the Royal House of Orange-Nassau. As a Dutchman, I have to say I don't mind him. He's a thoughtful person with a good heart. As heads of state go, I think we could have done a lot worse. So could Americans, for that matter. Think only of Ivan the Terrible, or Vlad the Impaler, or indeed the Roman Emperor Caligula, who notoriously appointed his favorite horse as consul of the Senate. We haven't seen that in either Dutch or American history. With the royal name Orange-Nassau, it is not an accident that these Dutch kids are wearing orange t-shirts. Orange is the national color, a fact which hasn't always escaped notice at international sports events. It is that same House of Orange-Nassau to which Princeton University owes its own distinctive color, and to which our main street downtown owes its name, Nassau Street. For Princeton, or Princetown, is named after another member of the same royal house. He is Prince William of Orange. William was the ruler of the Netherlands who, one day in 1688, had the luminous idea to invade England, depose the king, and have himself crowned in his place. That made him king not only of England, Scotland and Wales, but of the American colonies as well, and his wife Mary, the queen of all those territories. As a couple, they are the William and Mary who gave their names to the well-known college in Virginia. So it was a funny moment when King William Alexander, shortly after his coronation, paid his first state visit to the United Kingdom. He was welcomed at London City Airport by the current incumbent of the British throne, Elizabeth II. From his private jet to Buckingham Palace, they made their way through the streets of London, first by car, and in the last 2 miles, in a horse-drawn carriage. It was a lovely day, and there was plenty of waving to do to the assembled crowds. Yet there were also a few quiet stretches in almost empty streets, where the two royals filled the silence with the sorts of idle pleasantries that help you through awkward situations. In one of those stretches, their skills at polite conversation were put to a severe test, when all of a sudden one of the horses let out a thunderous fart. It was as if the air was rent asunder. It shook the carriage, and the blast kept reverberating off the walls of the houses. For a moment there was astonished silence, but with some effort the two royals quickly regained their composure, and once again they looked like they were having a really good time. Until, that is, the air started to become denser and denser, with a heavy noxious odour that seemed to want to cling to every surface. It was as if the horse had a pipeline going directly to the most sulphurous pits of hell. It was suffocating. But there was nowhere to look. There was nothing you could do except sit there and hold tight till the carriage would reach the next crossing, and a breeze would waft it all away. But the conventions of polite conversations do not allow for long stretches of silence. The Queen, being the host, had to act. And she said the only thing you can say in such circumstances. It is to respond as if you had accidentally forgotten to put sugar in the King's tea. "I'm frightfully sorry," she said. But the king, ever the gentleman, replied graciously and magnanimously. "Oh, that's quite all right, ma'am. If you hadn't said it, I would have thought it was one of the horses." What you just heard is an example of a joke. You don't say, Professor Wegman. When I first heard it, in England, nearly 30 years ago, it was told in a racist version. Fortunately, jokes are almost infinitely adaptable. If it is a seriously bad idea to ridicule groups of people to which you don't belong, you can still make the joke about your own people, whether it's your family, the folks in your neighborhood, your state, your profession, or your nationality. As a Dutchman, I can make it about the King of the Netherlands, for my fellow countrymen will know that it doesn't express the disdain or the prejudice of people living in another country. And it is, in fact, quite believable, for the Dutch are notorious for being brutally direct. Say if you had lost 40 pounds over the summer months and arrived at work hoping that somebody would say something nice, you could expect a Dutch colleague to pay you a compliment like, "Hey, you used to be really fat." But I said, almost infinitely adaptable, for there are limits to the changes you can make. The joke I just narrated is found also in the book you see before you. This was issued by a press in Bloomington, Indiana. As you might expect in an American publication, the visiting head of state is not the King of the Netherlands, but President George W. Bush. Here is that American version. Although I'm not an expert at analyzing and theorizing humor, I distinguish three parts in the story. They differ in the amount of narrative change they can tolerate. I call the first part the introduction. This is the section that allows the greatest scope for narrative variation. All it needs to do is bring the Queen and a visitor together in one place and have them be in the presence of horses. And you can take all the time you like to turn that into an entertaining narrative. I remember one version in which it was the Archbishop of Canterbury who comes to have tea with the Queen and is then taken out to the stables to admire the horses. The possibilities are endless. The second part is what I call, for lack of a better word, the setup. You can change many things, but not the flatulence. There has to be something so absolutely alien to the Queen's royal dignity that only a Dutch king or an American president or an Anglican bishop could believe she had admitted to it, and then offer her the assurance of his initial belief, which is that only horses were capable of emitting such toxic intestinal gas in such quantity and with such uncommon expulsive force. Of course, they had been proven wrong by the Queen's admission. But the important point was that this possibility hadn't even occurred to them. Such was the esteem in which they held her royal person, and such the esteem in which they would continue to hold her. Or such, perhaps, was their sexist and ageist assumption that she, a 90-year-old woman, could not possibly have the physical strength of a draft horse. The Queen's awkward apology is another thing that cannot change. The wording may differ from version to version, but the apology has to be there, and it has to be ambiguous in order for the visitor to misinterpret it in his response. But now we come to the third part, and this is the part that brooks no variation at all. It's the punchline. Narrative embroidery is going to ruin that one sentence, and thereby the entire joke. For the punchline is the identity of the joke. If you've forgotten the punchline and then do a Google search for the few keywords you still remember, say Queen, horses, carriage, president, you're not going to find the joke unless you narrow down the research. Nor will the results include any versions that involve visiting kings, sultans, sheikhs, emperors, or chairmen. If you happen to remember the key term for the second part, which begins with F and ends with T, the joke will immediately appear among the first few results. But just as immediately, it will drown in a sea of other websites, and once again you'll have to narrow down the search. But now do a search for the phrase, "thought it was one of the horses," and nothing but that phrase. If you put the phrase between double commas, the only result you get is the joke in every permutation, nothing else. The importance of the punchline is evident also when you tell the joke to someone who has heard some version of it long ago. During the introduction, they will not say anything, but keep wondering if this is perhaps the same one they heard. Maybe it isn't. But no sooner does the setup begin with that same FT word, or they'll say, wait a second, is that the one where... And then they will identify the joke by paraphrasing the punchline as best they can remember it. Now you will say, what is all this in aid of? What is all this stuff doing in a course on music? Well, one of the topics in today's lecture is the transmission of music in the absence of writing. It's oral transmission, and it is one of the terms you'll need to know for the midterm exam. In the syllabus, it is defined as the passing on of songs, stories, and lore by word of mouth. Oral transmission is how music survives for centuries when there is no way of writing it down. It sounds like something really antiquated, something that people did in the olden days, long before you could download the complete Bible in a zip file of 4 megabytes in a matter of seconds and store it on a flash drive the size of a fingernail. Why hear it in real time when you can do an electronic text search? Oral transmission is how one imagines stories and tales and songs were passed on by our distant ancestors, like in this nostalgic painting called Grandmother's Story. But it is not so antiquated. Oral transmission is alive in the practice of telling jokes. And one can use that practice in this example to illustrate the defining features of such transmission. Just going in random order, jokes don't work well in print. They must be told. Let's say I'm watching TV and a stand-up comedian begins to tell one. From that point, I'm unlikely to switch off the TV until I've heard a punchline. It may take a while, but if it's a good comedian, the story leading up to the punchline will already be entertaining in itself. On the other hand, I rarely have the patience to read a joke in print, even though that is certain to take a lot of less time. The joy lies in the telling, in the delivery. If it's done well, I could repeat a video of it again and again, and laugh every time as though it was the first time I heard it. The telling is so important that there are jokes whose humor lies entirely in a meaningless punchline after a story so extravagant as to raise expectations to the breaking point. A good example is the joke known as The Aristocrats, which was the subject of a feature-length documentary in 2005. Don't watch it before you have a fair idea of what the joke is about. And then there is the aspect of transmission. When I was a kid, any joke I heard over lunch at home was sure to be passed on to all my friends before the end of the school day. That illustrates why oral traditions keep going. Retelling was the first thing I thought of. It never once occurred to me to write down a joke. What could that be good for? There was a time, not so long ago, when a Google search for oral transmission would lead you directly to the extensive literary scholarship on the subject. But now, the only results you will get are about COVID-19, oral transmission. You'd have more luck searching for oral tradition, which is effectively the same thing. The classic study of oral tradition is the book you see here, The Singer of Tales by Alfred B. Lord. The focus of this book is on the two epic poems by Homer, composed about 2,800 years ago, the Iliad and the Odyssey. To state the redundantly obvious, these poems have survived as written products. But the poetry bears all the hallmarks of a text that was once a tale in the repertoire of a skilled performer, a true singer of tales, as the title says. One of these hallmarks is the freedom to elaborate. And doesn't Homer use that freedom? When my son got interested in Greek gods and heroes, the daily bedtime reading began to include the entire Iliad and Odyssey. In the Iliad, it became obvious very soon that the poet could keep the story going on forever. In every day of battle, he was sure to mention yet another hero whose name we had never heard before, and who seemed to be introduced for the sole purpose of being killed in some interesting way a few pages later. This is what Alfred Lord would describe as formulaic. It is not unlike the way Gilbert Gottfried could keep the aristocrats going on forever. But don't watch it unless you know what you're doing. Yet, in every oral tradition, there has to be a core that cannot change. In jokes, it is the punchline. In other cases, it depends on the significance of the material to the people who pass it on. Let me give you an example. It is the Scottish folk song Barbara Allen. We find it mentioned in British sources as early as about 1650, and the text was printed not long after. Here is how the song would have sounded in those days.
In Scarlet Town, when I was born, there was a fair maid dwelling, made every youth cry well again. Her name was Barbara Allen, all in the name.
Yet by the early 20th century, it seems the song had virtually disappeared in Britain. It lived on chiefly as an object of historical scholarship. But then a surprising discovery was made in Virginia's Blue Mountains. All those centuries, the oral tradition had in fact continued in remote mountain regions, communities that were almost perfectly sealed off from industrialized society. Here is a sample of one of the very many field recordings that were made not long after this discovery.
In yonder's town where I was born, there was a fair maid dwelling, made every youth to weel and woo. Her name was Barbara Allen. One day
The moment of discovery was brought to life in fictional form in the movie Songcatcher, which was released in the year 2000. This is one of the very few movies that feature a musicologist as the protagonist of the story. Yes, we are boring people.
Was in the merry month of May, when all gay flowers were blooming, sweet William on his deathbed lay, for the love of Barbara Allen. He sent his servant to the town, he sent him to her dwelling, saying, "Master sick and very sick, and for your sake he's a dying."
The ladies, where did you learn that song?
My granny gave it to me.
Was your grandmother from England?
All this brings us to today's key concepts. Oral transmission I have already introduced. Notation is a novelty. It must have existed by about the year 800, but that is not the important thing about it, at least not in the context of this course. The question is why anyone would go to the trouble of writing down something whose sole purpose was to be performed, not read. Plain chant had lived for centuries without the help of notation. So why all of a sudden did it need to be invented? Likewise, the song Barbara Allen was passed on for centuries in the Blue Mountains. A written copy would more likely have been a hindrance than a help. When there is one fixed version, individual performances may end up being regarded as mere variants, rather than versions in their own right. The Homeric poems were not written down until long after the poet's death. Who decided to turn his performance into a literary product? What was the advantage of producing one authorized version against which performances would forever be measured? The recitation of memorized texts would forever take the place of creative storytelling. I don't have the professional competence to speculate about literary traditions, but in musical traditions, the sudden move to writing usually indicates that the tradition is in some way contested or under threat. For example, there may be disagreement over the correct version or the correct way to perform it. When that happens, one needs a notated copy to settle disagreements, or to prevent them from happening in the first place. suddenly there is a premium on uniformity, and notation becomes a tool to enforce it. This is a new mindset. In scholarship on the subject, one often finds the conceptual pair written versus oral, like they are opposite poles, representing two fundamentally different mentalities. Well, after notation is invented, the West will not let go of the mindset that comes with it. Music will end up becoming a thing, an object, a commodity, that can be bought and sold, copyrighted, analyzed, edited, downloaded. That is a new development. Let's quickly trace the historical path of notation. Here is one of the earliest sources, copied sometime after the year 900. It is plain chant, notated here in the distant ancestors of modern notes. I speak of ancestors because there is in fact a direct lineage extending from these pages to our own time. The symbols are called neumes, and what we see before us is item number one in the awesome mix, the plain chant Tecum Principium. This is the first phrase with just the words Tecum Principium. There are no staves. Musicians will not perceive the need for staves until several generations later. There is in fact no effort to indicate precise pitch relationships at all. For us, there is no way of telling whether the next pitch is up one step or up the leap of a third, or in some cases whether the next pitch is up at all, rather than the same, or going down. Let's play this sample and follow along in the neumes. Now, there's one thing we can be sure of. If this notation was invented to settle disagreements, then it's unlikely that the disagreements were about pitch. At best, the notation provides the general contour of the chant, and even that contour is only approximate. Compare it to modern notation, which is designed to be perfectly specific. Each pitch is well defined. So if we trace the contour in modern notation, it will be pretty much exact. The only thing it cannot convey is a B flat. But fortunately, there is none here. The contour illustrates the smooth fluency of plain chant. Leaps are few, and they are limited to thirds and fourths only. And if we give different colors to syllabic and melismatic passages, we see the text placement typical of chants like this. The first few notes are syllabic, like a seagull running to gather speed, wings outstretched. But then the plain chant becomes melismatic, and it's like the seagull becoming airborne, soaring effortlessly through the sky. Let's listen to this one more time and follow along. And yet, soon there will be a time when notators want to be more specific about pitch. Here we find Tecum Principium again, but now we find it in a later manuscript written in more accurate pitch notation. This is that same passage we heard a moment ago. It may look as if the neumes are still free-floating, wandering about on the page, without a clear indication of how they relate to one another. But if you draw horizontal lines for each of the pitch levels, you end up with an almost perfect stave. That cannot be coincidence. I suspect that the scribe did actually draw these lines, but not with ink, but by pressing them in with a lead point. At any rate, staves will soon be drawn in ink, usually red ink at this time. The image here is taken from a manuscript copied around the year 1200. The red ink has worn away a little, but I have made enhanced lines that will slowly fade in and then fade out. Once you draw lines, you'll have to find a way to tell singers what pitches they represent. This is tricky because the spaces between them also represent pitches, and that could create confusion. Yet the problem is easily solved. Just pick the one line that corresponds with a note called C, and mark it with the letter C, like so. This letter can now serve as the interpretive key to all pitches around the line. In Latin, the letter was in fact called a key, a clavis. But that usage has not been literally adopted in English, for the word key is already used for other important things, like the keys in the keyboard, or the keys of tonalities, such as C major or F sharp minor. What musicians have done instead is use the French word for key, at least as it was written at the time this usage began. The French pronounced it as clé, as they still do, but in those days they wrote it as clef, and that is the word we still use to anchor staves. I will come back to this in a later lecture. Before I move on, let me point out one other feature. These are black square notes, far more easy to read than the dots and dashes of earlier notation. Square notation would become universal in the writing of plainchant and is still used for it today. As a musical genre, plainchant has not undergone significant changes in style, so the notation that was useful around the year 1200 is just as useful now. It is quite different with polyphony. This type of music has been continuously in flux, always moving along with the times. Let's have a look at the early polyphony in our awesome mix and see how it was written. The last time we heard polyphony was also the first time we heard it. It was the music sung at Winchester around the year 1000. But now we're going to leap forward more than a century to awesome mix items 6 to 12. There's a lot going on here, but let's review it step by step. This image shows two-part polyphony notated exactly like plainchant, red staves, at neumes that begin to approach square notation. There is a separate stave for each of the two voice parts. They are placed on top of each other and divided by that green squiggly line between them. Here is the sounding end result. Now, remember that this is plainchant notation. Plainchant doesn't move in a fixed rhythm, and so it does not distinguish between long and short values. Now, that's fine when there is only that one tune of monophony. But here we have two separate tunes, and they need to be coordinated. This is in fact imperative, because the polyphony is not note against note, or at least not the whole time. There are different numbers of notes going on at the same time. And whenever there is a difference, it's the top part that has the larger number of notes. Look at those first few notes far left, over the words portum in ultimo. Indeed, this is portum in ultimo, the heart-stoppingly beautiful item number 6 in the awesome mix. The second of the three words is in. If you look up from that word, the bottom stave has one note, but the top stave has three. So when I speak of coordination, the question really is, what durations to give these various notes? The notation doesn't tell us. The solution adopted by the performers in the recording is the one that makes the most sense. You begin by drawing imaginary bar lines between successive syllables. Now it is much easier to see that the bottom part is in fact syllabic, having only one syllable to each note. The top part is not really melismatic, but rather something in between. Against the one note in the bottom part, it sings either one, two, or three notes. About halfway down the staves, the text has the word ita, with the first capital I drawn much larger than the lowercase letters. From this point on, the music repeats what we've heard before. So we'll need to focus only on the first half of the example. The important point here is that there is no regularity to the number of notes in the top part. Just read along. The first syllable has one note, the second syllable two, the third three, and after that one, 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 three, two, one, one, two, three, one. Now, for coordination, you need regularity, but it does not come from the top part. Regularity can only come from the bottom part, which is, in fact, perfectly regular, one note to one syllable throughout. So the performers decided to give each note in the bottom part the same duration. The notes in the top part could then be fitted in accordingly. Here is what that looks like in modern notation. And here, again, is the recording. Now let's take a look at awesome mix item number 7. At the top right corner of the image, you can see written in red ink the words Magister Albertus Parisiensis, Master Albert of Paris. Unfortunately, we know nothing about this man except that he wrote this piece. And its chief claim to fame is that it's the earliest known composition in three parts. If we see only two staves, it is because the bottom stave is shared by two voice parts. One of these has red notes, the other black ones. Here is how you could write the same thing in modern notation. And now let's hear the music. In this piece, the performers made a different decision about coordination and rhythm. We don't need to look at it in great detail. The important point is that they decided to speed up the music whenever all voice parts had only one note to a syllable. Like you see there on syllables 4, 5, and 6. Ant, ka, to. I think that decision makes sense too. For if you don't speed up at those points, it's going to sound like the music suddenly slows down. A quick look now at the part writing. I've traced the outlines of the voices, giving each its own color. It doesn't exactly clarify a whole lot. Not just yet. If you were to conflate the two staves, things would begin to look very tight. Congaudian Cattolici is in fact a very compact setting, because all three voices are crawling within that same tight space of one octave. But that tightness is not a problem at all. In fact, it sounds great, at least if the voices blend together well. It's what we still enjoy as close harmony. But if you compare Congaudians to the standard distribution in modern choral music, known as SATB, it is clear that we usually like such music to be much more widely spaced. You could compare it to the 8 keys of the hydrolus, which also encompass an octave, as opposed to the 88 keys in the modern grand piano. I will come back to all this in later lectures. For now, let's just stick to that one octave of Master Albert and stretch it out vertically. There are two features that stand out. They're important because they will remain influential in music up to the present day. The first resembles the actions of a president who takes office and decides to do the exact opposite of everything his predecessor did. Right now, I can't think of a concrete case in history, so the analogy is strictly hypothetical. It is called contrary motion. Here you see how that works between two of the three voices. It's almost like Newton's third law of motion. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. I had to memorize Newton's laws in high school. Now, 45 years later, it is the first time they come in handy. The other feature is what happens when you press three voices in the space of one octave. It is voice crossing. Below becomes above, and above becomes below. Voice crossing is another term you may be asked about in the midterm exam. So here is an overview. The earliest complete sources with early neum notation date from around 900. The notation itself is probably a century older. At first, the notation is not pitch specific, but over time, musicians wanted to be more specific. And so, about a century and a half later, we find the first staves and clefs. What we will be moving towards now is rhythmic notation. There comes a point when musicians really need notation to be absolutely exact about rhythmic durations, just like that point two centuries before when they needed it to be exact about pitch. Around 1200, they succeeded in working out the problem of rhythmic notation. The particular solution is quite complicated, and it isn't critical to the aims of this course. Suffice it to say that the solution was applied in the notation of this manuscript. On the right-hand page there, you see the music for Awesome Mix item number 13, Alleluia Nativitas, by Magister Pirotinus of Paris. And here is the particular section we're going to listen to. What can I say? It rocks. Those singers in the age of cathedrals, the Gothic era, they tore the roof of the house. And it's not just the rhythms. Once again, the voices move within the space of one octave. The moment-to-moment sonorities are absolutely gorgeous. There is no text in this passage, no text underlay. This is the complete freedom to indulge in sound for its own sake. If any analogy comes to mind, it is that of stained glass windows in Gothic cathedrals. In the following clip, I have combined the musical sounds with an interior view of the Sainte-Chapelle, which was built in Paris just when music like this was all the rage. When you step into that chapel, you will see the miracle of walls that look like they're made entirely of glass. Awesome Mix number 18, called Summer is Ecomen In, is only a little later than the music you just heard. Why is this a fun piece to listen to? Well, number one, it is the earliest known composition in the English language. The language is somewhere between Anglo-Saxon and the kind of Middle English we encounter in Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. For a speaker of modern English, the text makes only a certain amount of sense. We can guess the theme from the first two lines. The first seems to say, summer is coming in, or has come in. And the second seems to invite us, out of sheer joy, to loudly sing cuckoo. Let's find out if the music confirms this guess. For those of you who haven't seen Guardians of the Galaxy, the dancing tree sapling is Baby Groot. Now let's look at the modern English translation. Since I'm not a native speaker, I'm always worried that I may mispronounce an unusual word. So please forgive me if I do. Here goes. Summer has come. Loudly sing cuckoo. Seed is growing, meadow blooming, and the woods are blossoming now. Sing cuckoo. The ewe bleats after lamb. The cow lows after calf. The bullock starts. The buck cavorts. Merrily sing cuckoo. Cuckoo, cuckoo. You sing well, cuckoo. Never deceive now. Sing cuckoo now, sing cuckoo. Sing cuckoo now. And here is the manuscript of this lovely piece. It's lovely because there's a canon in the top parts, with one singer after another joining in, each with the exact same music and text as the previous singer. The fullest version of this canon starts at about 1:07. Check it out. The rhythmic notation in this piece is very much like our modern notation today. There are two different note shapes for different durations. Both are black squares, but the stem on the right-hand side is used to mark a longer duration. The notation is not difficult to read. Played slowly on the piano, it works like this. And here are the corresponding shapes in modern notation. Nowadays, there is a far more expanded arsenal of note shapes. This table comes from your textbook. Of the various values, I will expect you to remember only three. These are the ones at the top: whole note, half note, and quarter note. Now, if we want to go all the way and notate summer is a common properly in modern notation, there is one more thing we need. It's a time signature. Look at this example of modern notation. There's a vertical line going through the stave at regular intervals. That line is like the lines on a ruler in the sense that the distance between them should always be the same. That distance is the measure of duration. And the lines marking off the measures are measure lines or bar lines. The only question now is how to define the measure, or to put it more specifically, how many notes of what values go into one measure. It's the time signature that tells us. It shows two figures on top of each other. If they look like a fraction, it's because that's what they are. They're a fraction of the whole note, the one you see in the table all the way at the top. In this case, the measure is 3/8 of a whole note. That may sound unhelpfully complicated and impractical until you realize that there is in fact such a thing as an eighth note. In the table, it's the fourth level down after whole note, half note, and quarter note. Not unsurprisingly, the table prints eight of those eighth notes in the space corresponding to the whole note at the top. But actually, 3 is enough to define the measure of this particular piece. And while singing, you count those 3 notes as 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and so on. You can also decide to have larger measures and to draw the bar line after every 6 values of 1/8, like so. In that case, you'll have to tell the performer by writing the corresponding fraction, 6/8 rather than 3/8. So, here's the concepts we've covered today. It's quite a bit to take in. And there is yet one more term, polyrhythm. I've tried to find a fun way to illustrate it. You're about to watch the theme music of a TV show I really loved as a kid. It's Mission Impossible. Yes, the distant precursor of the Tom Cruise movies, which actually used the same theme music. The opening clip of the TV show takes me right back to the 60s and sends a shiver down my spine. Ah, to be young again. While watching, keep an eye out for the countdown in the top right corner, about half a minute into the clip. At 0, you'll hear what happens when you have different instruments moving simultaneously in different time signatures. For me as a kid, this was the single most thrilling moment in what was already a spectacularly awesome piece of TV music. When I watch the Tom Cruise movies with my son, that's the moment I'm always waiting for. When it doesn't come, I'm stupefied. How could they omit this of all moments? To explain what's going on here, let me show you the rhythmic layers separately. The first has 4 quarter notes in every measure. It's easy to count the beat. It goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. But this rhythm appears only briefly at point 0. The TV theme as a whole has 5 quarter notes to the measure. And so the time signature is 5 over 4. You count it as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. Now let's put them together, and this is the result. And as a reminder, this is what it sounded like in the video clip you watched a moment ago. And now enjoy the awesome TV theme of Mission Impossible in the final slide.